Before we get into a discussion of how to evaluate a limit, let's start just by explaining what a limit is. Here's the definition, or just kind of an informal definition. A limit determines what value a function approaches as the x values get closer to some number. And the notation is written like this. We write lim, x arrow to c, which stands for the limit as the x's approach c, for a function f of x, and that limit will be equal, typically we write the letter L. This is capital L, some number, which stands for the limit. Looking at it on a picture, as the x's on the x-axis get closer and closer to c from both sides, we're interested in where's the function going, where's the function headed as the x's get closer to c. So usually they'll converge to some limit L right there. Now, there's a lot of details we have to hash out, though. Okay, let's start with a simple example and then just kind of try to pull out some of these details from here. All right, first of all, the limit as x gets closer to 3 for the function 2x plus 1. So if you look at the graph and you look at these x values, as the x's get closer to 3 from both sides, then it's pretty clear, if I draw little arrows on this yellow graph up here, that the y values are going to be getting closer to 7. And in fact, the answer is 7. But there's some kind of behind the scenes things going on here, some technicalities that need to be addressed. The big question students usually ask me the first time they hear limits is, why can't we just take this number here, 3, and plug it in and get 7? Why do we need to talk about the y values getting closer to a certain number as the x's get closer to another number? It looks like we're just trying to make it confusing for no good reason. Well, here's the main thing you need to remember about limits. This will really serve you well throughout this chapter. The limit technically doesn't care what happens exactly at c. It really is concerned with what the function's doing around c, but is completely irrelevant what the function is, particularly at 3. Like for this example, if this is f of x right here, f of 3 is also 7, but you can almost even just chalk that up to a coincidence. It's the limit and the function value, but the more important thing is that it's the limit. That's where the function values are headed. Yes, it happened to agree with what the limit was, that happened to agree with what f of 3 was, but you know, again, that's not the main point. The limit doesn't care exactly what happens at c. It cares what happens as you approach c. Okay. Here's another example just to kind of draw out this difference a little bit. Here's a function, and I'm looking for the limit as x approaches 4 for the function. So as the x's get closer and closer to 4, I'm going to keep my eye on the function. I'm going to draw little arrows if that helps, just to try to see where the function's going. Now, as a side note, f of 4 is 7. The y value of 4 is up here. I have a filled-in dot at 7. However, the limit that doesn't really care what happens at 4, I care what happens as you approach 4, the limit would actually be 5. So make sure you guys understand the difference between a limit as far as what the function's approaching and what the function value is at that particular x value. So big, big difference. Sometimes they overlap. If you have a continuous function, they're the same thing, but it's not necessary. All right, now there's multiple ways to evaluate these limits in calculus. Typically, most instructors teach three techniques evaluating limits: graphically, numerically, and something called analytically. We're going to tackle the first two in this video, and then we'll make a separate video for the analytical method. The names pretty much tell it all. If you want to evaluate a limit graphically, very simple, you're going to look at a graph and see if you can determine where the function is going. So I'm not really going to write a lot of notes for this one. Instead, I'm just going to kind of walk you through a very large example that has pretty much every scenario under the sun. Let's just look at this one here. All right, so I've got a graph that's just ripped all apart, points everywhere, it starts, it stops, open dots, closed dots, you know, the whole nine yards, even an asymptote here. And so I've got a bunch of limits here, and let's just go through them one at a time. If you want to try to beat me through these, you can push pause on the video and work them all out, and then push play, and then I'll finish it out. The first one's the limit as x approaches negative 5 right here. So I'm asking, where does the function go as the x's get closer to negative 5? Well, I look on the left side of negative 5, and as I get closer to negative 5, I reach some value. And let me stick in some y values here real quick. We'll call this 1, call this 3, we'll call this 5, for instance. So from the left side, it looks like the y values are getting closer to 1. From the right side of 5, the immediate right side, not way over here, but the immediate right side of 5, it looks like these y values are getting closer to 3. Now, somebody said, okay, what's the limit then as x approaches negative 5? You technically can't say 1 because the right-hand side would disagree. The right-hand side would say, no, actually, my y values are going to 3. You can't say 3 because the left-hand side of negative 5 would say, well, no, we're going to 1. You can't do anything silly like average the 1 and the 3 and say, well, I guess the limit's 2 because neither side is going towards 2, which is in the middle. I've heard this argument before. Somebody might say, well, Devin, the left side kind of wins because that's a closed dot and this is an open dot. That's not true because remember that the point I emphasized back here, the limit could care less what happens exactly at C. Closed dot, open dot, it's irrelevant. So that doesn't make a difference. So what do we say? Well, the common expression, if you can't give one definitive answer, one definitive number, we say the limit does not exist. There's not one number that the function approaches. Now, the more common notation is capital DNE. You'll see this in most textbooks, capital DNE. It stands for does not exist. All right, a little quicker. The limit for the function as x approaches negative 2. I'll use orange for this one. From the left of negative 2, it looks like it gets closer to 3. But from the right of negative 2, looks like it gets closer to the x-axis, 0. It kind of looks like it does not exist, but then we notice this point up here, and so we say, well, maybe the limit's 5, because at negative 2, it's a filled-in dot. Again, I don't care what happens at C. That's irrelevant. This one's another DNE. This one's a does not exist. Okay. Let me actually squeeze in another one, just I was noticing on my picture here. I think this one would be a good one. Let's say this is 2, the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x. Okay, now I've got a vertex here, I've got a point, but the limit as x approaches 2, the left side and the right side both tend to 3. So this limit as x approaches 2 would be 3. All right, the one at 3 right here in particular is another does not exist. And then the last one here at 4, I'm going through this kind of quickly. I might need to make a separate video on this. But you notice how the left-hand side and the right-hand side of 4 both tend upwards. So you have to be really careful what you say here. The natural thing to say is that the limit would be infinity, maybe. And in fact, that is what we say. But be careful here. When I write that the limit equals infinity, I'm not saying that the limit exists because infinity is not a finite number by definition, obviously. So there's no fixed number that the left and right side of 4 approach. Instead, when I say infinity, and that's the right answer, I can't say infinity. I'm describing how the limit doesn't exist. I'm explaining how the limit does not exist. Now let me actually tweak this example. Don't write this in your notes just because I don't want to mess up your notes or anything. But let me just tweak this slightly here. What if I had an open dot at 3 and maybe it tended downward from there? So if I redid a couple of these examples just kind of on the fly here, right here at 3. And matter of fact, actually the one at 4 as well. Okay, I'll use yellow for these to denote the difference. Now the limit as x approaches 3, it would exist even if I had a filled in dot up here or I didn't, it doesn't matter. The limit as x approaches 3 in this scenario would be, what do you think it'd be, 5 or 1? The answer is 1. It would approach 1. I don't care what happens at 3. I don't care that there's a dot up here. The function value approaches 1 from both sides. Now, when we get to this infinite limit at the asymptote as x approaches 4, well, from the right side, we approach positive infinity. From the left side, negative infinity. That one does not exist because I couldn't even give a consistent infinity symbol. I couldn't say positive infinity, but it's not negative infinity either. They're going to different places. Now, the second way to evaluate a limit, I'm going to go through this one very quickly, is numerically. Some of these limits, like let's look at this one. This is a popular one here that's covered in a lot of Calc 1 classes. The limit is x approaches 0 for sine x over x. If we tried plugging in the value like we did for this easy example back up here, right here, where we got 7 because the function value at 3 was the same as the limit, you notice you get 0 over 0. Sine of 0 is 0 divided by 0. So we're tempted just to say, well, I guess the limit doesn't exist. I got 0 over 0, so I'm going to the next problem. But again, I'll say it again. The limit doesn't care what happens at 0. You can have a limit exist at a certain place and the function not be defined there. It could be like that open circle idea that I had in the previous exercise. So what we can do is we can make a table. Now, I just did this one on my calculator real quick here. And what you do is you enter in your function, and then you go to your table and you generate a bunch of points around where we're curious about. In this case, 0. I don't know if I have a good color that will show up well here. But you see, at 0, we get an error. But if you look to the left and to the right side of 0, you get 0.985, 0.993, 0.998, and it's pretty clear to see as you approach 0, it looks like this is getting closer to 1, not just from the left, but from the left and right side of 0. So that would go to show that the limit is in fact 0, even though it's not defined specifically at 0. Right, so this is a good technique as well. Now, why don't we just use these te two techniques forever? There are some downsides to these two techniques here. One, we'll just take the numerical technique first of all. It's kind of hard to decipher the answer if it's not at a nice, pretty integer value like 1. If the answer is actually 0.9995 for a particular problem, it would be difficult to tell that numerically. Because we might interpret it to be 1, which technically would be different. Same thing with graphically. My graphing skills aren't that great. So if we thought a limit was 1, well, maybe it's not exactly 1. Maybe it's 1.1 or 0.97. It's just hard to tell graphically. So they are good in certain circumstances, but there is a third technique as well. It's called analytically, and we'll look at that in the next video. Last thing I want to grab real quick in this video is the notion of a one-sided limit. If you have the same notation here, but you add in a little minus or a little plus sign in the upper right-hand corner of C, that's not an exponent, that's indicating a one-sided limit. So that's the limit of the function just from the left or just from the right. Just from the left if it's a minus sign, and the way I remember that is from the negatives, from the left-hand side, versus from the right, which is from the positives, from the right-hand side, and coming from that way. So looking at a simple example here, just to kind of help explain the difference, I've got three different limit problems here. Let's actually start with the third one here. If I said, what's the limit of this function here as x approaches 2? Well, by now we should know that this would be a does not exist type of limit. Because from the left side it goes to 2, and from the right side it goes to 6, and those don't agree with one another. Even though the function's defined at 6, defined at 2 and it equals 6, that plays no bearing as far as what the limit is. Now, if you look just from the left, in other words, if you cover up the right-hand side, just from the left, I think it's pretty clear that the limit would be 2. And just from the right hand side, it's pretty clear that the limit would be 6. So you can have one-sided limits exist and the overall limit not exist. Now, the notion of a one-sided limit actually makes it very clear when an overall limit will exist. And it's very simple. You need the left hand and the right hand limits to match. I tell you what, let me modify this example on the fly here a little bit. Okay, I'm going to tweak this. Let's say that's an open dot. Let's say this is closed dot here. So for this example here, let's just redo it really quickly. The limit from the left is 6. The limit from the right is 6. As a little side note, f of 2 is actually 2. It's not 6. It's defined down here at 2. But now when we get around to computing the limit as x approaches 2, well, what am I doing graphically? I'm looking from the left and I'm looking from the right. Well, they're both 6. So if you're curious if an overall limit exists, all you have to do is look at the two one-sided limits. If they match, then your limit exists. If those don't agree with one another, we say that the limit does not exist.